Once again today, I was thinking about and praying over what I should preach on Father's Day, and I could not find a better message than right where we've been when it comes to the subject of men standing up and being the men of God that God would have us to be. I look at the example here of Peter and John and the stand that they took, and that's the kind of men we need today, men that will take a stand. And so we're going to stay right in the book of Acts today. So get your Bible, if you would, and we'll stand together for the reading of God's Word in the book of Acts chapter 4. And we're going to read the first 12 verses of this great chapter of God's Word. The book of Acts chapter 4. What an example these men are for us today as we think about the subject of Father's Day today. If there's ever a need for men, it's today. For men to stand and be the men of God God has called us to be. And the only way we can be that kind of man is number one, to be saved, and number two, to be Spirit-filled. And this was the source of the power of the apostles. Chapter 4, verse 1. And as they spake unto the people and the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees, they came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in hold unto the next day, for it was now eventide. Howbeit many of them which heard the word believed. I love that statement, don't you, this morning? Many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. And it came to pass in the mar that their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander, as many as were of the kindred of the high priest, were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked him, by what power or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said to them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, and by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand before you whole. This is the stone which is set in naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, I want you to notice the phrase, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Let's ask the Lord's blessing upon the preaching of the Word of God this morning. Father, we come to you today. We thank you for the Word of God. We thank you for the words that we have read, that every one of them were given by inspiration. We thank you that every word has been preserved by divine preservation. We thank you, dear God, that we have an accurate translation of your precious words in our King James Bible. And Lord, we pray, dear God, today that by your Spirit you might do a work in our hearts and our lives this morning. I pray, dear God, that you might strengthen us, that you might build us up. But Lord, most importantly, may we focus today on this name which has been given, which is above every name, the name of Jesus. And we pray these things, and for Jesus' sake we pray, amen. You may be seated. The title for the message this morning will be this, The Power and the Influence of Godly Men. The Power and the Influence of Godly Men. It has been my habit for many, many years to read biographies. I love to read the lives of great men as well as great women of God. And there have been many that have had a tremendous impact. I don't know about you, but from the time I got saved, I wanted my life to make a difference. I wanted God to use me, even if I never became one of those great people, I wanted God to use me in the lives of other people. And I think about these men and the influence of the early apostles and how that the Lord empowered them on the day of Pentecost. And now they are beginning to fulfill the mission that God had for them as they begin to preach the gospel and multitudes are saved. But not only did we find them moving forward for God, but we find that opposition came. Amen? Whenever you're moving forward for the Lord, you know, there's an old saying, when God's blessed, and the devil starts messing. Amen? And there's truth to that. And the reality is, for instance, in your life, if you make up your mind, I'm going to have a prayer life, I'll guarantee you the devil will fight you. Amen? If you determine, I'm going to be a soul winner, I'm going to witness for Christ, I'll guarantee you that you'll find opposition. In other words, every time you make a move for what is right, you're going to find the devil will oppose you. And that's why the Bible says, above all, we take the shield of faith, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Don't think that this is a playground. Amen? I have a playground mentality about Christianity. No, this work is a work. It's a work to be done. I mean, it's a great work that we're involved in. I think about Nehemiah oftentimes, and he encourages me, because when he was trying to rebuild some things and build the walls out of the ruins, he faced some opposition. Amen? Here the early apostles are going to become spiritual wall builders. Jesus has already said upon this rock, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, you think about Jesus during his ministry, his greatest opposition came from the scribes, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees, but for the most part, it was the Pharisees. Now the Pharisees, and you may not realize this, were the fundamentalists of that day, but sadly, though they were fundamentalists, they rejected Christ. And though they should have believed on him, Jesus said, search the scriptures, for if then ye think ye have eternal life, he said, they are they which testify me. If anyone should have recognized that Jesus was the Messiah, it should have been those Pharisees who did at least claim to believe that the Old Testament was inspired. Amen? But I think it's interesting as you move from that stage to the apostles. The great opposition comes from the Sadducees. You say, well, preacher, what's the difference? Well, you probably heard the saying in Sunday school that they were sad, you see, because they did not believe in the resurrection. And so when Jesus rose from the dead, this was a clear attack upon their lack of theology. Amen? This was an attack upon their liberalism, because they did not believe that the Old Testament was inspired. They did not believe that angels were real. They did not believe, the Sadducees did not believe in a future resurrection. They were religious, but they were lost. Amen? And now the opposition comes from the Sadducees, because the Sadducees know that these early Christians now are preaching on the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In fact, on the day of Pentecost, as Peter gets up and preaches, he boldly preaches on Christ crucified and buried, and the fact that Jesus, God raised him, it was not possible that death could hold him. And he preaches on the resurrection, and for the Sadducees, this is a threat that they're following. Amen? And so they come together. Now, I want you to notice, first of all, in this passage, the opposition that they face. Look, if you would, in chapter 4 again. The Bible says, as they spake unto the people, the priests of the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection dead. They didn't like the message. Amen? And you know, we're living in a world today where people still do not like the message that we preach. You know that? You say, preacher, why? Because we preach that Jesus Christ is the way, the true life, that no man comes to the Father but by him. That's too narrow-minded for this world. This world's of the viewpoint, well, all roads lead to heaven. It doesn't make any difference what road you get on, as long as you're sincere. That's not what the Bible teaches. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's very plain. There's no other name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. And so they were opposed to the message. This world is still no friend of grace. There are still those today who believe that we are haters, because we believe that it's through Jesus Christ and through him alone that we are saved. You may say, well, preacher, how can we believe that? Well, the Bible teaches it. Amen? He's the only human being that was ever a virgin born. He's the only human being that lived a perfectly sinless life. I don't know about you, but I haven't lived a sinless life. I haven't even lived sinless since I got saved, let alone the mess I was before I got saved. But Jesus lived a sinless life. He was a lamb without blemish and without spot. He lived a perfect life. Jesus Christ went to the cross in fulfillment of Bible prophecy, Isaiah 53, Psalm 22, and many other passages. And he went to the cross according to the scriptures. He suffered. He died there. But he conquered the grave. Praise the Lord. I think every time we share the gospel, people, we need to speak about the resurrection. You say, Pastor, why? Look in your Bible. And I shared this with a gentleman yesterday. We had the privilege of leading in Christ. But look in the book of Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. And this is the wonderful plan of salvation. You may have come today wondering, how can I have a relationship with God? How can I be saved? Well, we want to make it crystal clear. Chapter 10, the book of Romans. Notice in your Bible, in verse 8. But what said that the word is denied thee? You know, America has no excuse. The Bible's available. Daniel and I were talking the other day. You can walk into a dollar store and for 10 bucks or less buy a wonderful copy of God's word that's very readable. In fact, the one you carry, I think, is a $10 Bible out of Dollar General. Amen? And what's God saying? God's saying the Bible's not someplace distant or far that you have to go find it. It is nigh us. There's not a person in America that could not get a copy of the Bible if they desired to. Now, there are many people's groups in the world that don't even have the Bible translated in their language. I certainly admire missionaries who go to some of those people groups. And I think about there are some people that have no written languages. The Benedict's daughter and son-in-law are down in a Mexican village in South Mexico. And they're reaching some people that have never been reached with the gospel, but they have no written language. And so they're actually developing a written language for their people. And then they will be translating the Bible into a written language so they can read the Bible for the first time themselves. You know, we take that for granted. We can walk into our house, and probably many of you have multiple Bibles. I couldn't even begin to tell you how many Bibles that I have. But the point I'm making is the Lord is speaking to Israel primarily here in this sense. The Word is nigh. It's available to us. It's in our heart. It's in our mouth. Even the Word of faith which we preach. Look at verse 10. Verse 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and here's the key, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised from the dead. Do you understand that the teaching of the bodily, physical resurrection of Jesus Christ is a necessity for salvation?
Yeah.
You may ask, well, why? Because only a living Savior can save. A dying Savior who's still hanging on the cross has no power to save me. The fact that Jesus conquered the grave means that he had the power to conquer my sin and your sin as well. And so the reality is that we preach Christ crucified, buried, and risen again. And you don't have to wait for one Sunday in Easter to do that. Amen? It ought to be preached every time that we preach. Every time we testify, every time we witness, we need to share with people that Christ died for them, and he was buried, and that he rose again the third day. Because without the resurrection, there's no salvation. We must believe in our heart that God had raised him from the dead. And this was the Sadducees' problem. They not only did not believe that Jesus rose, they did not believe that anyone will rise. Aren't you thankful that because of the resurrection of Christ, we have a future hope of a resurrection of this physical body as well? Now, I'm not one that believes. I don't believe in soul sleep. I don't believe that when you die that your body rests in a cemetery and that's where you're at until the resurrection. No, I believe you're in heaven. Paul the Apostle said to depart and be with Christ is far better. It says in the book of Corinthians, very plainly, it says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. It also says very plainly, as Paul was speaking about his future departure, he said, my time of departure is at hand. I am ready to be offered. And he fully anticipated when he took his last breath to be in the very presence of the Lord. I like what David said. He said, I will be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. Amen. What a blessing to know that there is a resurrection. But we must believe in the resurrection. The Sadducees rejected that. But one thing they could not dispute the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. You see, what was their dispute? Here was a man who had been lame, that everyone knew had been lame from the time of his birth. Every time they went to the temple to worship, there was this lame man, and he was there begging for alms and asking for his very survival. And now the man was leaping and walking and praising God. And they had no explanation for that. And you know, I think about our world today, they can argue with all kinds of things, and they can dispute all kinds of things, but one thing that they cannot argue with and they cannot dispute of is the power of Jesus Christ to change the lives of people. Amen? The Bible says, if any man therefore be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. All things become new. And I tell the men and the women that we minister to in the jail all the time, I say, you know what? I've not seen hardly anyone successfully get out of jail and stay out without Jesus. Amen? He's the one that has the power to break the chains of sin and to break the chains of habit. And he has the power to change lives and to save lives. And he does it to the uttermost. Praise the Lord for that. And so as we look at God's word here, we find there was opposition that came. And I want to remind you that as a man of God, when you begin to do the will of God, you will face opposition. Opposition will come. Jesus made it very plain that the world will hate you. And we're living in that kind of world today. When you stand up for God's word and you repeat what God's word says and you stand for what God's word says, you're going to face opposition. This culture today is no longer in agreement with the Bible. Now, if you grew up years ago, you know there was a time when you could believe the Bible in America, and the majority would say, you know what, that's true, it's right. We don't live in that world today. We live in a world of great opposition to the truth. But that does not give us any luxury to compromise, amen? We must stand upon the Word of God. We must be the men of God, the women of God, that God has called us to be. And so we find that the message they opposed the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you go back here to the book of Acts with me this morning, let's go back to Acts chapter 4. I want you to notice the boldness of these men. The boldness of these men. The Bible says that all these groups came upon them, the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, the Sadducees, which were the religious leaders of that day, being grieved that they taught and preached, and taught the people, and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Well, not only was there verbal opposition, there was physical opposition. Look at verse 3. And they laid hands on them. Now, in soul winning work, I've had some people that have treated me mean. Amen. I've had a few doors slammed. Maybe you have as well. Maybe you've taken a cussing once in a while. I've done that as well. I've had some people give me a good cussing. But the reality is I've never been arrested for preaching the message that I preach. And I'm thankful to God for the freedom we have in America, aren't you? The First Amendment of our Bill of Rights says that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. That is a God-given right that we have in America that was enumerated by our Bill of Rights. Your Bill of Rights does not give you your rights, it enumerates them. They came from God, and so they're worth standing and fighting for. Amen? Do you believe that this morning?
Amen.
That our liberties, our freedoms are worth standing and fighting for? But you know, we need to understand, just as we pray for the suffering church, many Christians throughout the world do not have the religious liberty that we have in America. And as bad as America has become, and it is bad when you see it promoting sodomy as acceptable, when you make a hero out of someone who does not understand whether they're a boy or a girl, and you make a hero out of them instead of those who have laid down their lives for their country, we're in trouble as a nation, amen? And I don't apologize for saying that today. We live in a confused, perverted, twisted world. And it's only become that way because we moved away from the anchor, which is the Word of God. We cut loose from the anchor, and when you cut loose from the anchor, there's no limit to how far the boat will drift away. Amen? And this country is going to drift because we broke our anchor. We cut ourselves loose from the Word of God. George Washington said that it's impossible to rightly rule the world without God, the Bible. We're trying to do both. We're trying to do both today. And I think about our nation. And this is a nation, if you ever study Isaiah chapter 1, a nation that God said is laden with iniquity, that is literally bowed under iniquity. And the sad thing is that the repercussions of that, the reaping we are doing, is the violence we see every day in our country, ready to erupt at any moment. And so our nation has certainly moved away from its moorings. We've cut the lines and we've gone adrift. We need to get back to the Bible. You know what troubles me the most is not so much the world doing that, but the church doing that. At least those who profess to be a part of the church. There's a leading minister in our community that's very influential in evangelicalism, Tony Coppola. And he has recently publicly come out and said, well, the church needs to be more tolerant of homosexuality. God doesn't give us that liberty. Amen. We've got the Word of God. Now, I'm not saying we should be hateful. I'm not saying we should be unkind. But we must stand for what God says is right. What God says is sinful and perverse is still sinful and perverse. God has not changed his mind about those matters. Amen? And for evangelical leaders to come forward today and try to influence the church to lighten up, if you will, on preaching against what God condemns, I'm sorry, we don't have that luxury. We're ambassadors. Amen? An ambassador doesn't have the luxury to give his own opinion. Amen? Ambassadors represent their king and their kingdom, and God hasn't changed his word. Amen. It's still the Word of God. And so we must stand as men. These apostles, they could not help but preach what they knew to be true. Jesus Christ was crucified. Jesus was buried, but Jesus conquered the grave. Amen. And because he conquered the grave, now the power that rests upon Christ rests upon them. Jesus said, greater works than this shall these do, because I go to my Father. And now the Holy Ghost has been poured out upon them. And now they are going forth in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the dead and the lame are being raised. And so now the Sadducees begin to bring opposition to them. And now it becomes physical. They arrest them. They lay hands on them. They put them in a hold on the next day. Look at verse 4, howbeit many of them which heard the word believe. It's so encouraging. The Bible says, so that faith cometh by hearing. Mm-hmm. And hearing by the word of God. You say, preacher, what do we do for our culture? We need to do what we always did as the church. Preach the gospel. Amen? We need to be on the highways and the byways and knocking on people's doors and showing the love of Christ and preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, witnessing to our neighbors, our loved ones, our co-workers, our friends, Christians need to get serious about reaching the people in their lives. Amen? There's people you work with that need Christ. There's people you live next door that need Christ. There's people you do business with that need Christ. There are relatives that need Christ. People need the Lord. Amen? They need Christ. And the church is going to have an impact because people within the church begin to have an impact. These early apostles could not keep it to themselves. And not only that, there were miraculous things that happened. And many of them would share the word. I've just learned this over the years. If you preach the word, somebody will get saved. Amen? The word of God has the power. It's kind of like seed. You plant seed, it's going to grow. It may not all grow, but some of them will. I think about oak trees. You know, they throw a lot of acorns. You get around a big oak tree, and there's a lot of acorns. Not everyone becomes an oak tree, but some of them do. Amen? That's why there's still oak trees. Because some of them did. Well, you know, if we're a type of a church that is scattering the seed, the Bible says if we sow bountifully, we'll reap bountifully. If we sow sparingly, we will reap sparingly. You want to have a bigger harvest, then sow more seed. Amen? The more seed you sow, the greater your harvest is. The early church, daily in the temple and in every house, they ceased not to preach Jesus Christ. And the early church went from 120 to 3,000, but now here they're 5,000. That's quite a bit of growth. Amen? I mean, nowadays they'd be out having a church growth conference. And inviting people to come and see how it's done. But the reality is, it was not what they did, it's what God did. It was the Holy Spirit and the influence of the Holy Spirit in the life of Christians who were energized, who had made Christ's thing the main thing in their life. You know, the problem with most Christians today, it's sort of like Christianity's on the side. If I have time, I'll fit that in. It's not their main thing anymore. I didn't think about the early church. What if your pastor said to you, I think we ought to come and tarry for 40 days and pray for the Holy Ghost to fall upon our church. Amen? Most people say, well, preacher, enjoy your prayer meeting. I hope you have a good time. Amen? The early church, from the time that Jesus ascended till they went back, from the time he resurrected, then he ascended, and then for those days, those 10 days, they tarried and they waited for the power of the Holy Ghost to come out of the church. And let me see the marvelous and magnificent things that happened on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Ghost's power was poured out upon the early church. But we see that the message that was opposed in that day is still opposed in our day. The message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want you to notice the answer of the apostles. Look with me, if you would, in verse 5. And it came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and the elders and the scribes. Here's all the bigwigs gathered together against the apostles. And Annas, the high priest. He was the highest one in charge in the religious world. And Caiaphas. And John and Alexander and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem, and when they had set them in the midst. Here they're on the spot. Amen? They were set in the midst. The Bible says that he asked them very plainly, by what power or by what name have you done this? Now that was a wonderful opportunity. Amen? I'm sure the disciples were waiting for this kind of opportunity to give the answer that God gave them. By what power? By what name have you done this? By the way, they could not deny that the miracle was real, that it was genuine, that this man had been lame from his birth. They could not deny that his life had been changed. He had been marvelously healed by the power of Jesus Christ. I want you to notice the message of Peter as he boldly preached in the power of the Holy Spirit. I love this. Verse 8. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost. My, what a contrast between the Peter who was there warming his hands at the sinner's fire. And there were several that came and said, were you not one of them? And he denied the Lord three times. And the last time when a damsel said, well, I know he's one of those followers of Jesus, he cursed and swore. You said, well, how could God take a swearing, cursing man and just a few days later transform him? It's called the Holy Ghost. Amen. I mean, here's a man that one time had said, I will go with you, Jesus, to judgment and death. And Jesus said, he said, before the cock crows, you'll deny me three times. And Peter didn't understand what he was saying. But the reality is, in the power of the flesh, he failed. But in the power of the Spirit, look how God used him. And by the way, he represents every one of us. How many of you in your life have made honest, dedicated resolves to do better, to do this, to do that, and you failed?
Amen.
You know why we fail? Because we're depending upon the flesh. The Bible says, the flesh profiteth nothing. Amen? It says that if we're saved, they who in Christ have crucified the flesh with its affections and its lusts. We have no confidence in the flesh. You know why? That which is born of the flesh is what? It's flesh. It's the old nature. No, we are to crucify the flesh with its affections and its lusts, but we're to live it by a higher power. Peter had to come to the end of himself before God could use him. And that's why Jesus said to him, he said, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. He said, but I pray for you, that your faith would not fail. But when you're converted, you will strengthen your brother. Look how God used Peter. You know something? Because of the experience, the bitter experience of failure that Peter went through, when God blessed him with great success, he never took it to himself. He always gave the Lord the glory. Amen? Had it been all about Peter, he would have thought, well, my, I'm a great orator. I'm a great speaker. I have this great ability to influence the multitude. No, he knew it was all about Jesus. It wasn't about him. And until we reach that place in our life where we realize it's not about us, it's not about our ability, it's about God's divine, supernatural power. And Peter, God can take this man and convert him and change him. Was he saved before that? Yes. Did he need conversion? Absolutely. Amen. Some of you sitting here today are saved, but you need a spiritual conversion like Peter had. And then God can begin to use you. Amen. God can't use anyone that he doesn't convert, and he has to change us. Amen. And sometimes it's a long process. Sometimes it can be a time of crisis like Peter went through. He went out and wept bitterly. According to church history, every time for the rest of his life when Peter heard a cock crow, he was so humble, he would weep. He would weep every time. Because it reminded him about how he denied the Lord. Good lesson, amen? Changed his life. Thank God for Peter. Thank God for the example that he had. You look at the Word of God, we find that God made a man out of him. He stands here and he boldly preaches. Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said to them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done on the impotent man. You know, you ever wonder why Christianity is being opposed so greatly in America? Think about that. I mean, we're not the ones blowing up buildings and killing people and tying bombs to ourselves, amen? And yet the Christian is being treated as though we're the great threat in our country, and yet there's a threat all around us of people who believe in pleasing their deity that they should kill other innocent people. And yet we get accused of being evil ones, the haters, and so forth. We know the reality is the most loving people in America are Christian people. I mean, who's building the hospitals and reaching out to those that are going through the ravages of terrible flood? I've never seen an atheist hospital yet in town. Have you? I've seen plenty of Catholic hospitals and Baptist hospitals and Methodist hospitals. Amen. I've never seen a hospital that said, first atheist hospital. Have you? Okay? Just it's not out there. Amen? It's not there. But if it is there, I've not heard about it yet. Okay? But yet, it was a threat to their religiosity. This early church became a threat to their power and their prestige that they thought that they had. And the Bible says he was filled with the Holy Ghost. He says, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to him, amen. You ever think about a community like ours, if every church was not here? And you know, we have some wonderful men of God in this community, and I praise the Lord for it. We have some wonderful men of God in this community. You know, I gather together on Wednesdays and have prayer with men that are pastors. And they're not all pastors of Baptist churches, but we come together to pray. One thing we pray for is we pray that God will put heads of protection around our schools, that we wouldn't see God men come in and kill children. Amen? We pray that God will put a hedge around us. We pray that God will visit our city with the Holy Spirit. I'm thankful to God to have men of God. Do we agree on every doctrine? Probably not. On the main ones we do. Amen. The essentials. But we're praying for our city. This city needs Christ. Amen. This city needs revival. And so does every other city. Amen. I mean, there's not a city in America that's not filled up with methamphetamine. Our city's filled with heroin addiction like you would not believe. In fact, when I heard about this young lady, the first thing that came to my mind was probably an addict needing money for a fix. First thing that came to my mind, that was not the case. She was mentally deranged. She'd been on mental drugs and been a real problem in the family and walked in there with a pellet gun. No one knew it was a pellet gun. sadly, her life was lost in her foolish acts. But I'm telling you, our city is filled with people that need Jesus Christ. They need to be saved. And the churches, for the most part, have a message that will just come in here. No, we need to go and tell. The gospel needs to be outside the doors of the building. This is a place where we are trained and prepared and equipped. But the mission field is outside the doors. Amen? Every time you walk outside the doors, there's a mission field of people that need Christ. And I'll be honest with you, people are open. They may be open to everything, but at least they're open to the gospel when you witness to them. Amen? What a blessing it is to go out in the community and to witness and preach the gospel. You pray for the churches. You pray for revival within our city. I want you to notice here, as you think about the Word of God here, I want you to notice as he preached boldly some things that he brought to bear upon these individuals. You know, when I think about it, I was meditating on this the other day as I was preparing this message. Look at the opportunities God gave Israel, even after they rejected Christ, to repent. The day of Pentecost, they were given an opportunity. They said, men and brethren, what shall we do? And multitudes did, but sadly the leaders did not repent and believe. Here's the second opportunity. God does the miracle of the healing of the lame man. Second, Peter gets up and preaches, and they have another opportunity, but he brings the indictment. Now this took manhood. I'm preaching today for Father's Day, amen? This took a man to do what they did. It took manhood energized by the power of the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 10. Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. There's still power in that name. Amen. You believe that this morning?
Amen.
I mean, I love to hand out gospel tracts, and I always tell people, I said, can I give you something good to read about the Lord Jesus Christ? Most of the time, they just can't refuse. You know what? There's power in that name. The Lord Jesus Christ, using his full title. Can I give you something good to read about the Lord Jesus Christ? And you know something? They'll say, thank you, or I'll take that. Hopefully they read it. Amen? Gospel tracts. We ought to be involved in sowing seed. My grandmother was such a funny example of that. She had up tracts everywhere. Her pastor is the one who wrote God's Simple Plan of Salvation. And we use that tract extensively. We use that tract a lot. We've given away thousands of them in Kokomo. But she would even roll them into toilet paper in a public restroom, so when you pull out toilet paper, a tract would fall out. I mean, she was creative in giving away tracts, amen? How many of you have ever done that before? Back rolled a tract into toilet paper roll? I've never done that. I probably should do it. I was talking to my pastor yesterday, my former pastor, and there was a little tract I'm looking for, and my father-in-law will remember this, Vernon Nestles, who was our printer at Baptist Temple. In fact, for years he was the printer at God's Simple Plan of Salvation. He was saved in World War II. He was in a flying fortress, a B-17, and the tail was shot off of him. And he was the tail gunner. He was a little guy. Vernon Nestles was a little guy, full of zeal. And then the tail was shot off, and he was falling in a parachute, and that's when he repented. He was falling into enemy territory, and between the tail being shot off of that B-17 bomber and the ground, he had repented and believed on Jesus. His life has changed. He was never the same again. He wrote a tract about it, but I've lost my copy, and I was talking to Brother Dixon yesterday. I said, preacher, do you know anywhere where that tract is at? If it's not in print, we need to get it printed again, because I need World War II veterans, and that'd be a great tract to give them. And so I'm going to try to see if we can get his life story, that little tract that he wrote. And I'm sure many, what an unusual testimony. And isn't it amazing the different places where God meets people and saves them? I mean, I can't even imagine that. But you know, now look what God did. But the power of that name, the name of Jesus, he said, by the name of Jesus, Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified. Which, you're the one. We didn't reject him, the nation rejected. You crucified him. But then he says, and this was what really got those old Sadducees worked up, amen? Whom God raised up. You may not believe in the resurrection, but Jesus coming out of the grave is a great affront to your false doctrine, amen? He did rise. He is alive. The resurrection is real. Jesus said, because I live, ye shall live also.
Amen.
He said, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. You know, you think about this today. You may not have been healed of lameness, but if you're saved, it's by his name that you stand here whole. I will guarantee as I stand in this pulpit today spiritually whole, it's not because of religion. It's because of Jesus. He saved me as a teenager. I was a mess. You may not believe that. I'm still a mess, but I'm not as big a mess now as I was back then. It's by the name of Jesus that I'm who I am today in Christ. And you can give your testimony as well. Who you are. Paul said, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And the reality is that every one of you that have been saved have been transformed by the power of the same message that healed this lame man. Praise the Lord. Look at the boldness of these men, the boldness. And then he says in verse 11, this is the stone which was set at naught by you builders. That was prophesied, by the way. When they were rebuilding the temple, there was a piece of irregular stone that no one knew where it went. And so they took it and they threw it off in the brook Kidron and it laid there. And yet it was an integral part of the temple that should have been included when they rebuilt the temple, but it wasn't. That's a type of Jesus. He's the piece that is missing from most people's lives and they don't even know it. The stone the builders rejected. Amen. He's the stone that a lot of people who try to build their marriage, they reject him. Trying to build a nation without that stone. Amen. Trying to build a home, trying to build a life. There's a lot of people still rejecting that stone today. The stone that the builders rejected. Before you got saved, you were trying to live your life without that stone. Amen.
Right.
I mean, you were trying to build your home without that stone. I mean, think about that today. Jesus is the rock of our salvation. Yes, he may not look like other stones. And they had no idea where he fit, and they left him out. Jesus said, the stone, the Bible says, this stone which was set at naught of you builders, it's become the head of the corner. In other words, the most important stone in the building. The most important one. And then he says in this passage of Scripture, he says in verse 12, neither is there salvation in any other. My. The power of that name. The power of salvation. There's no salvation in any other name. Is it the name of Allah? I mean, this whole idea that they call this now, they call it Chisholm or something like that. I think that's a cowboy movie. Amen? Chisholm, okay, saying, well, we all believe in the same God. We just look at it in different ways. No, that's heresy.
Amen.
The God of the Bible, the creator God that we worship and serve, is not named Allah. His name is Jehovah Yahweh God. Amen?
Amen.
He's expressed in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was worshipped as God. Never rebuked anyone for it. He was Jehovah in the flesh. That's the one that we worship today, is the Lord Jesus Christ. The stone that the builders have rejected. No, we don't just believe that there's different cultures of people that call him by different names. No, the reality is there's only one name. The name of Jesus. One name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. The name of Jesus. The Bible says neither is there salvation in any other. He's the only one virgin born. He was the only one prophesied. He was the only one that lived a sinless life. He's the only one that died for us. He's the only one that bodily conquered the grave and stayed out of the grave and never returned.
Amen.
And he's the only one that's coming back again one day. In great power and great glory. He's coming back. I'm not looking for the third imam or the fourth imam or whatever imam they're looking for. I think it's the seventh of us. I forget which one they're looking for. No, I'm not looking for him. Amen. I'm looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. That's who I'm looking for. Amen. I'm not trying to figure out who the Antichrist is, even though he might be in the White House. Amen. He may be an Antichrist, I don't know. But I'm not trying to figure out who the Antichrist is. That's not my job. I'm looking for the one who's going to come one day in great power and great glory. The one who promised. He said, if I go away, he said, I will come again. And I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. In my Father's house are many mansions, and if it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Our Savior's come back. He said, if I go away, I will come again. He's coming again. He's coming again in great power, great glory. And when he comes, he won't be voted in as king, and he'll never be voted out. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He will reign supreme. And we can rest in that today. Just as surely as he conquered the grave, one day the kingdom will come. His will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. The church has been praying that for 2,000 years. One day the church's prayer will be answered. But it will not be a day until the Lord comes. Amen. When the king comes, the kingdom will arrive with the king. Praise the Lord for that. And I'm thankful to be a part of this kingdom even now through the new birth. I want you to notice some things about these men. And this is a good Father's Day message by itself. The last verse. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, when they saw it, it had an impact. Amen? You know, there's just something about people who stand up for what they believe in the power of the Holy Ghost without apology. People take notice of that. We live in such a vacillating world where, you know, people just go along to get along. And pastors can be guilty of that. I'm just not that kind of a pastor. I'm going to preach the word, and if I have three people show up, then we'll enjoy it together. Amen? If I have 300 come, I'll praise God real loud. Amen? But the reality is this. I'm not preaching to please the people I preach to. I'm preaching the word of God because the Bible tells preachers to preach the word. Now, am I ever going to try to be unloving or unkind? No. I believe that every sinner needs a Savior. I don't care what their lifestyle is. Okay? Even if they're living that lifestyle that's being promoted as normal, that's not normal, we still need to show them the love of Jesus Christ. Amen? And show them that they are sinners for whom Christ died, and that they will repent and believe they can be saved like any other sinner can be saved. And they need to see nothing but compassion from the church. Amen? Now that does not mean lowering our standard or changing our belief. But they shouldn't feel isolated or condemned any more than anyone else does. You know, it's about like the preacher was preaching one day, Peter Cartwright, and General Thomas Stonewall Jackson came in. And of course, everyone got nervous. And the preacher, old Peter Cartwright, kept on preaching. They kept pulling his coattail. They said, "Don't you know that General Jackson walked in?" And old Peter Cartwright just said this. He turned and said, "You can tell old General Jackson if he doesn't get born again, he'll die like any other lost sinner will." Amen? I mean, I want to tell you something. We need boldness today. We need people who just get up and tell it like it is. Praise the Lord. By the way, General Jackson was one of the most godly Christians this world's ever seen. And if you read his life, most preachers didn't live the life of godliness that Thomas Stonewall Jackson lived. I thank God for that great spiritual leader of our nation. And he was a Southern Confederate general, okay? He said, "Well, that's awful. How can he be a Christian?" Do you realize that before the war, and all those things I said for free, before the war, he had a school teaching Negro children to read? That's what he did, okay? He had so much compassion for them. And so, you know, don't misunderstand. Don't get your history from a lot of people who don't know what they're talking about, amen? But he was a godly Christian, a man of God, who had a wonderful prayer life and believed in the sovereignty of God. You know, the reality is, you know that these men, the Bible says when they saw their boldness and they perceived that they were unlearned, and in other words, they weren't men with a lot of degrees behind their name. They were not people that had been through seminary. But he saw that they were ignorant, none of them men. But here's something more important than a degree, more important than going to a seminary, more important than having a bunch of PhDs beside your name. They perceived, they marveled, and they took knowledge of them, that they had been with Jesus. You know, what a transformation here. Think about this. Peter at one time had stood and denied that he even knew him. But now, in the power of the Holy Spirit, he had become the man that the Lord intended for him to be. But God saved him. Amen? Mm-hmm. He had become the man that God intended for him to be when he saved him. Here's the question. Are you the man? Are you the woman? Are you the person that God intended for you to become when he saved you? And I can use this word, I have to use it very carefully theologically, but has God been disappointed the way you've turned out? Amen? Has God been disappointed the way you've turned out? You know, God puts so much into us. He's so loving. He's so merciful. He's so gracious. And so many times, he puts so much into our life and gets so little out. Amen. Can we not agree on that today?
Amen.
This man had become the man that God intended for him to be when he saved him. The Bible says they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. What was Peter now? A good testimony. You know, that's the best a father can be. It's a good testimony. So when they leave, you know, I read a lot of obituaries. You say, "Well, that's kind of negative." Well, I like to check to see if I'm in there. Amen. Now, I want to see if I need to show up at Elders. Amen. For my final dressing. No. And I'll read it, and I'll read about, "Well, this man loved the Colts." Well, I like the Colts, but I hope that's not my obituary. Amen. Or this person liked NASCAR. That won't be in my obituary. Amen. I can turn right and left. Okay. So that won't be in my obituary. Okay. Some of you will get that for a while. But I think about this, is that the only impact they had in life? That they liked some sporting team, or they liked a particular race, or that? Or did their life really count? Were their people's lives changed because of their influence? What about their children's lives? Did their children say, "My daddy was a real genuine Christian through and through, that lived it, not just on Sunday, but lived it 7 days a week"? Will they say that about you? what a test would that be? You could leave nothing financially to your family, but if you leave that kind of spiritual legacy, maybe you've left something that's of value. Amen. People ought to be able to look at our life like they did the apostles and take knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. They marked and they took knowledge. And is that the kind of man on this Father's Day that you and I are? If we're not, let's ask the Lord to speak to us today. Let's have every head bowed and eye closed. Father, we come to you today, and Lord, we see no greater examples, hardly in the Bible, than these men of being men of God. And Lord, we know that Peter and John were not men because of themselves. It was because of the power and the influence of the Holy Ghost in their life. And Lord, we know, dear God, that we cannot be good men, good husbands, good fathers, good grandfathers, without divine supernatural power. And Lord, so often we try to do it on our own. Lord, we fail so miserably, so often, Father. But Lord, we thank you that on this Father's Day that we can honor men. And I thank God for the men today right here in our audience and in this church today that are men who have had influence in the life of their families, Father. And Lord, the greatest testimony that could ever be given about a man would be this testimony that they took knowledge of them. They marvel that they had been with Jesus. Lord, I pray, dear God, that we would be with you through salvation, then of course through a devotional life, through spending time with you. Lord, convict us if we've not been the men that we should be on this very day. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Amen.